Lorsque l'on envisage l'édition du génome pour le traitement, il faut qu'on respecte un certain nombre de principes, et tout particulièrement la balance bénéfice-risque et la question aussi du coût de ces traitements. Alors la balance bénéfice-risque, c'est bien entendu qu'il faut que ces traitements soient efficaces et ne soient pas dangereux. C'est des essais cliniques qui ont commencé et les résultats qui sont obtenus dans le domaine de certains cancers, de l'immunothérapie des cancers ou dans le domaine de certaines maladies rares, en particulier du sang, sont très prometteurs. Maintenant, un des grands problèmes, c'est que chacun de ces traitements doit être individualisé. Et cette individualisation du traitement coûte extrêmement cher, plusieurs centaines de milliers d'euros. Et la question, c'est qui paye ? La solidarité peut venir en aide à ces maladies rares. Mais quand il s'agit de maladies fréquentes comme le cancer, ce problème du financement est un problème majeur.
Some of the diseases that it has been suggested genome editing could be used to treat include the common monogenic diseases such as, for example, the inherited anemias, beta thalassemia, sickle cell anemia, cystic fibrosis. But genome editing also has the potential to target multiple genes at the same time, and that's what makes it a potentially powerful tool for correcting more complex disorders caused by multiple genes. There has been a distinction between what we call somatic genome editing and germline genome editing. Somatic cells are what we call the cells of your body, so skin cells, liver cells, essentially adult cells. Germline cells, on the other hand, refer to sperm, eggs, and early embryos, so cells that can go on to form the next generation. So the important distinction here is that somatic genome editing makes changes that will not be passed on to the next generation. They only affect that individual. Whereas editing germline cells may mean that we create a genetic change that is what we call heritable, that means it can be passed on. At the moment, consensus among scientists is that we don't yet understand the risks and the uncertainties surrounding heritable genome editing well enough to start carrying it out in the clinic. Studies are underway with scientists collaborating in order to better to try and understand the technique and to define what would constitute a safe translational pathway towards the use of heritable genome editing.
Reste un certain nombre de cas très particuliers, rares, dans lesquels l'édition du génome pourrait guérir des embryons atteints d'une maladie particulièrement grave. Aujourd'hui, la technique n'est pas au point et donc il serait totalement irresponsable de faire de l'édition du génome sur la lignée germinale ou sur des embryons. Si un jour la technique devenait sûre, alors il faudrait réfléchir dans quelles conditions éthiques très rares cette technique pourrait être mise en œuvre.
There are a lot of controversies in the research of human embryos. The reason why this is very controversial is that in some culture or society, human embryos are full human, so you can never use human embryos for research. But in some other countries, it can be a beginning of life, and in an exceptional case, it may be all right to use human embryos for research. So for clinical application of human genome editing, I'd like to point out two questions has to be solved. One is how to have a proper regulation for the world now. And the second question is more complicated, but in the future, what do we do if the technology becomes safe? And for that, I think we have to consider cultural diversity and also diversity of the need in the medical environment. So for these issues, I think truly global dialogue among many nations, among many people, diverse people, including patients and local people, are needed. And I really hope that UNESCO will play a good role for working on this question.
I think the potential social consequences of genome editing require that we have wide discussions about this. We try to understand what sorts of hopes and what sorts of concerns people have, and to try to make sure that if and when we move towards clinical application of these technologies, that it's done in a way that is scientifically responsible, socially acceptable, and ethically robust.